bad omens and bad luck from the beginning. Years before the flight, the spacecraft, as it was being built, had installed a damaged liquid oxygen tank. And it had been dropped at the factory. Factory people picked it up and made it sure that it would work fine for everything that it had to do to go to the moon. What they didn't do was to see if the little plumbing inside that tank was damaged, and that plumbing was only used to remove the oxygen on tests long before it had ever gone to the moon. If they had a fill up with oxygen and they wanted to take it out in some test, they never checked that. It was originally designated for Apollo 10. Because it was delayed in delivery, it was signed to Apollo 13. The Apollo spacecraft flew with a 28-volt DC system. The little heaters inside the liquid oxygen tanks, the heaters were used occasionally during the flight to boil off a little liquid oxygen to feed the spacecraft itself for its various things. Were protected by thermostats that were capable of handling 28 volt power. Around 1965, NASA, or the manufacturer, I don't know which, told the manufacturer of the liquid oxygen tanks to replace those thermostats with thermostats that were capable of handling 65 volt power, because at the Cape there was an availability of 65 volt power, so they just wanted to check one thing in the spacecraft and not turn up the spacecraft's power system. They could plug it in and use it. The manufacturer never complied with the directive. Worse still, NASA never checked that the directive was completed. 2 weeks before the flight, we did what was known as a countdown demonstration test. The spacecraft is all set to go. It's standing on sitting on top of, the Saturn V booster. Booster's not fueled at all, but in the spacecraft, everything is fueled. Liquid oxygen, liquid hydrogen, everything had to go. The crew gets into the spacecraft. The launch crew gets into their consoles, and we count down the time all the way to zero to make sure that everything in the spacecraft functions at the proper time. Power comes off, internal power, navigation system comes, oxygen starts to flow into the system. Test was a complete success. After the test, the ground crew went to the spacecraft and started to secure the spacecraft. One of their jobs was to remove the liquid oxygen from the new tanks. And when they tried to remove the liquid oxygen from the damaged tank, it didn't come out. Then they thought a while, well, why don't we put the 65 volt ground power that we have and boil the oxygen out? It worked fine for everything. We'll just let the heater system boil the oxygen out. They did. What they didn't know was the fact when the temperature inside that liquid oxygen tank, now you know liquid oxygen is about 200 and some odd degrees below zero, but when it got up to 80 degrees in that one certain spot at the top of it, the little points on the thermostat started to open up to shut off the power and protect it. But it was 65 volt power, not 28 volt power, and the little contacts were welded shut. We know now from tests after the flight that the temperature got up to around 400 or 500 degrees Fahrenheit inside that tank. Yeah. It's amazing that the tank never burst. Yeah. Nothing happened. The oxygen was removed quite rapidly, they thought, but it damaged the inside of the tank, exposed all the wires and damaged the heater system completely, but no one was concerned because there was nothing to show that there was anything wrong. The day before the launch, we filled up the tank with liquid oxygen, and it was a bomb waiting to go off, and that's how it all
that's the background. From there, you get into the lifeboat situation, just trying to get home from there. What was that like, those moments, those days trying to get back?
Well, we didn't get in the spacecraft when we found out 4 days before the launch that our entire crew had been exposed to the measles. I told you about bad omens. The doctors looked at our medical records and found out that Fred Hayes and I, having measles as kids, and our kids have the measles too, we were immune to the disease. Ken Manley was a bachelor. Never had any kids with measles, never had the measles himself. So he was dropped and Jack Swanker was put on board. That was the beginning of it. That was the second omen. But we launched on April 11th, 1970, at 13:13 Central Standard Time. Do you see a scenario? We took off on that big Saturn V. The first stage, of course, worked perfectly. When its fuel was expended, we dropped it. We lit the five engines on the second stage of the Saturn V. 2 minutes and 13 seconds before it should have, the center engine shut down. Do we have a crisis? What's wrong? Do we have enough fuel to keep going? To give Mission Control a lot of credit, they quickly looked at the situation, looked at the remaining thrust we had on the second stage and the fuel and the thrust we had on the third stage and said, yep, we can still go. And so we got into Earth orbit, checked our spacecraft, then lit the third engine the second time to get us all the way to the moon. Actually put us at us on the proper course and a proper speed of about 24,000 miles an hour, and we got into a long elliptical orbit all the way to the moon. Except on April 13th, the night of April 13th down here, just after I finished doing a TV program to show all the people on the world what we were doing, of which none of the networks carried, the tank exploded. And from then on, it was not the third landing on the moon, but one of survival.
So I think we could...